All right, well, welcome everyone today. My name is Heather Hava, and I am a PhD student at University of Colorado Boulder. And we're gonna talk a little bit today about how we can create better connections with plants and humans. So let's get started. I do wanna also thank everybody here for EurekaFest, and especially Marlena and all the Lemelson family. We couldn't be here without you guys, so I just wanna say that now. People often ask, so how'd you end up being an engineer? And of course, it's a long, sordid story, as you can imagine. And as our last speaker mentioned, that Legos were sort of a, you know, big part of that. I have to credit cardboard boxes, the most amazing prototyping tool ever. I highly encourage you, if you don't use duct tape and cardboard now, you should try that. Very high tech. We did see that with a flying car yesterday, a whole car made of cardboard that flies. So anyway, I did a lot of things, and when you're 4 years old and you want to be an astronaut, people think that's really great, you should go out and follow your dreams, and then you get to high school and now you need to start thinking about getting a real job and being an astronaut, not so practical. So you say, okay, well, don't listen to them, but you do have to make a plan. And I'm actually getting close to the end of my 10-year plan, which was to eventually get my degree. And I said, okay, well, I need to find astronaut-like experiences if I want to get in. One of the things I did was go and fly on the zero-gravity plane in undergrad and do research. I went to MDRS, Mars Desert Research Station, which is a simulation habitat in Utah, and spent 2 weeks trapped with 6 people I'd never met until we got to the airport. Very interesting experience. And I was the health and safety officer, so I thought, oh, well, I'm also a picky eater, as my family will attest to, that I really thought that, okay, it must fall under my job if I'm health and safety officer to also be the crew chef. That will guarantee I have something I like to eat. But cooking for 6 people for 2 weeks when you have a dorm room-sized refrigerator is quite a challenge, and we eventually had to end up rationing food. And I really started thinking about, wow, what makes a habitat home, and what is so important about the things we take for granted in our diets today. So the other thing is, people are like, well, you know, you don't look like a typical engineer. I'm like, yeah, I'm not. I'm really an artist trapped in an engineer's body, so don't worry about it. But artists and engineers really have a lot in common. We're pretty much one and the same. We just do things a little bit differently. And I do believe in beautiful machines. I think that's most critical in design. Creativity and innovation pretty much gets you to invention. So, you thought you came here for a STEM talk today, but really you came for a history lesson. Turns out that why we're all sitting here today is that we have big brains, and there's actually a lot of really big brains in this room. We didn't get here over a very, you know, it took us a little bit of learning how to cook and the whole food thing, eating high density nutrients, and eventually went from being a chimp to an astronaut. But there's a really important thing, which is actually the chimp was the astronaut first, so let's not forget that, and of course you can tell all of history with Legos as well. Okay, so what's the difference between exploration from the past and currently in the future? Not really a whole lot. It's same challenges or similar challenges. The way you conquer them is a little bit different. The explorers of the past had to make choices. Are you going to bring everything with you? Are you going to try and live off the land? Are you going to grow things? The Polynesians realized this, and they took their canoe plants. They took them to Hawaii, and they eventually were able to grow their crops. And that's happened all over the world. Our first canoe plant of space was lettuce. We recently got to eat, or the astronauts up there got to eat, the first crop grown in space and eaten was just this year. I work with the veggie team at Kennedy Space Center. So you also need a place to live. Remember I said that, so domesteading. We'll come back to that. Okay, another history lesson. How did the food system start? Now, who here really loves to eat strawberry cubes? Wouldn't that just be delicious to eat for 3 years? Probably not. And it turns out that that's what they started out with, but they were only there for a very short time, so you can tolerate it. And it, we got a little bit better with dehydrated and some of the kind of MRE, meals ready to eat type food. And then eventually, they did start sending fresh foods, but they only get the fresh food when they send a resupply ship, and it is not feasible to send fresh food on a resupply to Mars. So what are you gonna do? And that's why the veggie and hydroponic systems have been worked on. However, you know, are you there to be an astronaut and do exploration, or are you there to be a farmer? And we both know that they are equally a lot of work, take a lot of knowledge and training. We tend not to think about farming as high tech, but reality is it is extremely high tech. And what about maybe an astronaut farmer? Or even how about a robot farmer? Maybe that would make our lives a little bit easier. Okay, so people say, why space? Why don't you worry about the things here on this planet? And I do, I do every day, actually. I think about them when I'm working on designs, and we all should think about that. Right now, we have 7 billion people that we need to feed, and we currently need 1.5 Earths, which we don't have, to feed that many people. By 2050, we're gonna have a little over 9 billion people. And that's a tremendous load on the Earth. We all are gonna eat about 35 tons of food in our lifetime, approximately. And if you do the math, the numbers are, the zeros are so many, it doesn't even make any sense in your head. What does that really equate to? It comes out to be about 70% more food than we're growing today, or 2.8 Earths. Okay, so this is a problem. But the technology that can solve these problems in space can also solve them. We can solve a lot of problems here on Earth. Now, we always think of plants and food, of course, but reality is plants do a lot more things for us than we realize. Of course, they improve nutrition, but the sensory stimulation, you know, you are what you eat, and are we really eating our planet up? Those are things we have to ask ourselves, but self-sufficiency, is so important here and on space travel, but you know, of course, reducing resupply is a big critical goal. All right, so you're like, well, where's the invention here? Come on, tell us something we don't know. Turns out that engineers really good at killing plants, really good. Specialists at that. So we had to kind of learn how to grow plants. None of us knew anything about it for the most part. Back in the day, we all knew how to grow our own food. It was just part of daily life. We're all having to relearn that, or people who want to. And so you could see kind of the evolution of the prototypes we built and doing some robotics and that kind of thing. We eventually ended up with Spot and Roger, the robotic, Roger always screws me up, robotically operated gardening rover, and AgQ. Okay, AgQ, artificial intelligence for agriculture. Super, super important. We want to minimize the workload for astronauts. We also want to minimize workload for people, maybe home growers, that kind of thing. And these are the things we can do with AgQ. We can monitor, alert, diagnose, and predict. These are kind of the evolution of our interface that people can use on their phones, on the web, to access the data or set the parameters for the system. Now, it's not that fancy to look at a bunch of numbers and a bunch of graphs, but we can also take human data and monitor the astronauts' stress and use the plants to help the astronauts also relieve stress as well, and that's one thing that this system does that most don't. So we want to help each other, the plants and the humans, take care of each other. So we can go into the data, look at all these fancy things, do all these sensors, which is great, and everybody loves data, but what's really important is if you're only growing a couple of plants, you don't have enough data to do that much with as far as analysis or prediction. However, if you have a lot of people growing a few plants, you can aggregate that data or pool it and do what we call anonymous data aggregation, and now you can start to implement the advanced analytic tools of machine learning, which gives you decision support tools, or basically educates a grower that doesn't know what they're doing what to do. Could be handy if you're on Mars and you don't want to learn how to be a farmer before you go. Other things we can do is we're working with other people's hardware. We figured out really fast a lot of people make great hardware, And we could just pull that data in so growers who already have these systems don't need to replace that hardware to get the power of AgQ. Other thing is, by having the thermal imaging and multi other kinds of imaging processes, we can detect disease before the human eye can, at least 3 days early for a lot of nutrient deficiencies and diseases. So, that was a lot to say. What's the future? Dome steading, we come full circle. My other invention is a geodesic dome frame, and working on integrating those growing systems into the dome. Eventually, for obviously space travel is my primary focus, but turns out this would be great for earth applications, sustainable housing, disaster relief, urban agriculture, and that is what we're looking to implement in the early phase before we're there on Mars. We've got a little ways to go, so we want to get it into use and get a lot of data and practice and really refine it. And with that, I will end and say thank you very much. Again, special thanks to Marlena for being wonderful, my family, especially my husband, who's also my IT support, and NASA for funding me and the XHAB team.